Jim Browdy moderate tonight because he's host of Greater Boston and Boston's co-host with Marjorie Egan of Boston Public Radio. And if any of you have heard him on the radio, sounds like he has one of the more fun jobs around.
Two of the most fun jobs.
Two of the most fun jobs. But anyway, let me turn it over to Jim. Thank him for coming, and we'll go from there.
I feel like that, you remember the guy who ran for vice president who said, who am I and why am I here? Brock answered the who. The why is a little bit tougher. Usually when I moderate forums, I know a lot about the subject matter. This is an exception to the rule. I know nothing about the subject matter. So I'm sort of like a traffic cop tonight, but I think I can do that fairly well. And so what are the reasons why I wanted to accept Brock's invitation? One, my mother used to say my personal motto should be borrowed from Alice Longworth Roosevelt, who once said, if you don't have anything good to say about anybody, come sit right next to me. And that's generally my motto, but I have to say, I'll make an exception tonight to be in the presence of leaders of the Harvard Stem Cell Institute, people like you and you, who are changing the world, is really an honor. And I hope in the two programs I have and the work that I do, that I'll be able to gather something from tonight and try to help, with your help, communicate it to our listeners and viewers. And I also hope when I leave, I can, remember the great line from Barack Obama when he was talking about climate change? He said, I'm not a scientist, but you know what? I know a lot of really good scientists, and I hope by the end of the night I'll be able to say that too. The second reason why this mattered to me is I am a fan of, what's the word? I'm a fan of asymmetry. And what I mean by that is, what's a good example? Years ago, I went to the ART, the American Repertory Theater, and at noon, I saw Bryan Cranston play Lyndon Baines Johnson in All the Way. It's a story, this beautiful story about how Johnson cajoled senators and others into voting for the Civil Rights Act of 1965. That was at noon or 1 o'clock. Here's the asymmetry. At 8 o'clock or 9 o'clock or 10 o'clock that night, we had a party with my co-workers at WGBH to watch the finale of Breaking Bad with the same Bryan Cranston playing Walter White, the meth-producing former high school teacher turned killer. And so I had Bryan Cranston as LBJ at noon and Bryan Cranston as Walter White. Now you may say, what does that have to do with that? Well, I'll tell you what it does. This morning on the radio, we had Jonathan Gruber. I don't know if people know who he is. He's from MIT. He's one of the architects of the Affordable Care Act, and actually of Romney Care. And one of the things we were talking about was not only the state of the Affordable Care Act in the Senate and other health care things, Medicaid in particular. He wrote a piece in the New York Times today that is terrific about what Medicaid really is. And it's not just for those people, as he said in the piece. But he went on and on about how painful it was for this country that there's no science advisor to the President of the United States, and what message that sends about how science-based or not policy will be in this country. So that's the asymmetry. Go from Jonathan Gruber talking about no science advisor in the White House. By the way, Barack Obama appointed a science advisor on March 9th of 2009. He didn't waste any time. From no science advisor to be in a room with all of you talking about what you're talking about tonight is the perfect asymmetry. So that is why I agreed to do this. So these are your four presenters. Actually, that's the third reason I agreed to do this. I just realized when Maureen told me there was no PowerPoint tonight, I said, I am there. That's how I feel about it. So there's no PowerPoint. What's going to happen here is each of them are going to speak for about 15 minutes. And you're not going to ask questions, if you don't mind, until all four of them are finished. The little pieces of paper or cards you have, I'm told by Maureen, the hope is, in an attempt to be relatively orderly, that you're going to put your name on if you want to ask a question at the end, and maybe the topic of your question, and we'll get to as many of them as we possibly can. We don't mean to be overly anal about this, we're just attempting to be organized. So if things, as they go along, if you hear a speaker, and there's something you want to ask him or her, or if there's a question you'd like to direct to the group, please fill out the card and give it to Maureen or one of the people here. The other thing that makes me really happy, and this is the last thing I say about being here, is in a country that grows more insular by the day. When I looked down the list, Arlotta, Italy, Rossi, Canada, Egan, US, and Ott, Austria. I mean, that's sort of, in my opinion, the way it's supposed to be. So in any case, thank you so much for having me. I'm thrilled to be here. I really hope to learn a lot. and Pellet here to start things off. Thanks so much.
Oh, you need that, don't you?
I'm
sorry.
Well, thank you so much for being here tonight. I also told Maureen the same thing, that no PowerPoint presentations. I'm here because I think there is really a value to this conversation. So I won't speak for too long because I think the best part of this is when you get to ask questions about what we do. But I wanted to give you a little bit of sense for who I am, what we study in my lab, and most importantly, sort of the trajectory that led us from being very basic developmental biologists to actually doing work that I think will contribute one day to understanding of neurodevelopmental and neuropsychiatric disease. So I'm a developmental neurobiologist by training. What that means is that I'm interested in understanding how the brain is made in an organism, how are all the different cell types that are present in the brain made, how they connect with each other, and how these wonderful organ that allow us to do what we're doing right now, talking, listening, moving, comes about. And so I'm driven by this kind of fundamental question, but I never felt that that was sort of enough for me. And so instead of joining sort of basic neurobiology departments, I joined early on the Department of Stem Cell and Regenerative Biology here at Harvard, and pretty early on also the Harvard Stem Cell Institute welcomed me. And the reason for that choice is that I felt that I could really, with this kind of community, begin to apply the knowledge I had of development of the brain to think about how to actually generate replicas of the brain, the cell types, for example, that are present in the brain, their connections, in vitro from stem cells to begin to understand human disease. There is no clear path of how one does that, but it was very clear to me from the very beginning that one way to do it is to really surround yourself with exceptional colleagues across a variety of different fields, and you see some of us here. Nobody knows everything, clearly, and you really need your colleagues to build science at the intersection of fields. And the second thing is that I knew that in this environment, I had colleagues with a vision. I had people that liked to take risks in science for higher goals, and that were never afraid of asking big questions if the return was very important. So that kind of philosophy and inspiration in science is really what has driven me and the people in my lab over the many years, and what this environment turned out to be fantastic for us. So I'll now tell you a little bit about something that we did very recently. So I started by saying that most of the work that we have done many years ago and that we continue to do is to try to understand how the brain is made. But then over the years here in Boston and over a lot of interactions with these colleagues, we learned a thing or two about stem cells and the potential that these cells have to generate virtually every cell type present in the body. And so we decided to take on the challenge of seeing if we could take stem cells, human stem cells, and instruct them to generate a tissue that would have some resemblance to the human brain. And why would we like to do that? Well, there are prominent diseases like autism, for example, or schizophrenia, in general, and neuropsychiatric illnesses that are very, very complex diseases. They're overly human diseases that if you know patients with this disease, you immediately think about how the behaviors affected are really overly human, is something that makes us human. And what we've learned from the genetics of these diseases over the last few years is these are not simple diseases where you have a mutation in a single gene and you manifest the disease. Oftentimes, the majority of these cases are diseases where you have small differences in the function of many, many, many genes across the genome. And collectively, this genome gives you a certain likelihood of developing the disease. And so you're faced with the challenge of modeling something that is overly human, that requires the entirety of the human genome, that affects part of the human brain that a mouse, for example, barely has, the prefrontal cortex, for example. You need to model it to begin to understand what is wrong in these diseases, what cell types are involved, what kind of molecular mechanism, what kind of molecules are affected within the cells that can one day be become targets for intervention for drug druggable targets. And so one day we began to think about this more and more, and decided to try to see if we could take stem cells and then foster a process of development of the human brain in the dish. And what that builds on is on this sort of interesting characteristic of the brain, that the cells that initially build the brain, in a way, know how to build it. We don't know how to build the brain, but the cells themselves, within their nucleus, have all the information to generate the many different cell types that are present in the brain. They can come together in a specific way to form the primordium of the brain, the initial part of the brain, which then can potentially develop in the dish, not to generate really a brain, but tissue that resembles some of the features of the human brain. And so we've been able to succeed at growing these brain organoids. They're not really organs, they're organoids that resemble the endogenous tissue for a very long time in the dish. And what we have seen over time is something I think quite interesting. I'm very excited about this, actually, is that over time, in the same sequence in which cells of the brain are made in vivo, these organoids make the same type of cells. Not all of them, but many of them. They make neurons, the cells that connect with each other and communicate with each other. They make different types of glia, which are the supportive cells of the nervous system, very, very important. And many other different cell types. And all this information is just present within the nucleus of those cells. They can do it. And if you wait long enough, these neurons will wire together and they begin to communicate with each other. And this process of development was quite interesting to watch. And we soon realized that we had an opportunity here to now begin to use these systems to understand something that we could never understand before, meaning, what does the genome of a person with a patient with one of the diseases I mentioned to you does to the development of this brain? Are the cells different? Are they all formed the same? Do they express the same kind of genes? What is affected within the cells? We could never look at this before, and now we have models where we can begin to look at this. And so the hope for this kind of work is that starting with development, with sort of a routine understanding of how the brain normally develops, and I think that's very important. It took a very interesting journey that required interaction with my wonderful colleagues in stem cell biology, and a lot of, you know, vision in a way, and interest in doing something new and different. And then led us to models that clearly, we'll have to be developed farther, but then one day may unlock some of the secrets for what really goes on in a brain, in the brain of a patient with a neuropsychiatric disease, and also serve perhaps as a platform, as a cellular platform on which we can screen drugs that may ameliorate some of these effects. So I think this is a particularly interesting journey, and maybe of all the people on this panel, are the most basic scientists. And it's very exciting for someone like me to actually see that this interest in brain development may actually lead to an understanding of human disease, which is something that I thought I would never have the opportunity to do. Now, this kind of science requires taking risks, and therefore, by definition, it cannot be funded by traditional, more conservative funding sources. There is too much risk you take at the beginning. You don't really know where you're going, except you have a lot of knowledge to figure out obstacles as they come about. And so this is where HSCI has made a difference for us. No question asked, if the project was interesting, if it was high risk, if the ultimate goal was worth the science, then it would get funded. And this was the spirit from the very beginning, and very grateful that was what accompanied this journey. So that's my story.
Well, thank you so much.
All right.
Derek Rossi, and by the way, I'm not being rude, I hope, you know, by not introducing people. You have all the background on them on your sheets.
Yeah.
Figured we'd save time so we could get to your questions. Derek, you're next.
Hello, everybody. Happy to be here. So I believe Brock asked me to be here to sort of tell you about one particular story that goes back in the lab, now 10 years, that turned into, I guess, a bioenterprise. And the story that I'm going to tell related to that is actually a story of, I would say, working outside of one's comfort zone and out of one's own sort of knowledge base, and sort of having data that arises that steers you in a direction that you didn't think you were going to go in, and then seeing at the end of that that yet again there's a new opportunity that's presented that you weren't envisioning at all in the first place. So it's really, I would say, a sort of a story of happenstance, if anything. So I did not get the memo that it was a no slide presentation. No, in fact, I did, and then I didn't prepare slides, but then I got this email today that said, oh, you're two slides. So I was like, okay, two slides. So I put them together this afternoon, and instead of tomorrow, you had like five this evening, so they're here. So I might as well have them. I can't actually see them, but just say the background of my lab, I'm trained as a hematopoietic stem cell biologist, and actually this is the stem cell that is really the paradigm through which we have sort of think about all other stem cell types, and it's actually the stem cell that's been in the clinic the longest. So it's the functional unit of bone marrow transplantation. It's been being used in patients since the 1960s, and that is really largely what we study and continue to study. However, in 2006, Shinya Yamanaka published this absolutely outstanding paper showing that you could sort of reprogram somatic cells to these pluripotent stem cells, these induced pluripotent stem cells. And we saw that paper and read it. I read it, it was a year, 6 months prior to starting my lab, and I just thought it was so fantastic that it inspired us to dabble in that, which is, again, outside of what we normally do. And so I had a postdoc who took up the challenge. So when Yamanaka published his paper, he did so using, as you all may recall, sort of integrating retroviruses to sort of induce these somatic cells to turn into pluripotent stem cells. So we thought, and there was a lot of debate in 2006, that this would be hard to translate this because it's integrating viruses, and one of the reprogramming factors happened to be a potent oncogene. So we thought, there was a lot of discussion about how could you make these cells in a way that might be safer for clinical translation eventually. So we thought, well, why don't we, you know, just sort of skip the whole DNA part and try to reprogram with mRNA. But we all know that this is basically the triumvirate of life, you know, DNA, RNA, protein, life. So we thought, let's just remove the DNA and try RNA. We were not RNA biologists at all, but we pulled out a textbook and made sort of textbook RNAs and put them into cells, and it absolutely didn't work. And the reason that it didn't work, and I'm sure that we weren't the only people to come up with this really clever idea of like, hey, let's use the mRNA instead of the DNA. The reason it didn't work is because ever since viruses and cells first met one another, and I'm talking about RNA viruses have been trying to figure out ways to get into cells, and cells have been trying to figure out ways to keep RNA viruses out of cells. So cells have developed these very acute sensing mechanisms that basically shut down the cell's ability to translate proteins and ultimately commit altruistic suicide when they see a potential virus infecting them. So sure enough, you try to put mRNA into a cell, and the cell says, oh, that looks like an RNA virus to me, let's kill ourselves. And indeed, we were very, very good at killing cells in the dish. And so that could have been the end of the story, but we turned to the literature. What do you know? There's amazing stuff in literature. You just have to dig a little bit. And some really impressive work coming out of UPenn, which was basically studying how RNA elicits immune response, which is being done by Caitlin Frico and Drew Weissman at UPenn. And they were using short little stretches of RNAs, and they showed that if you incorporated a couple of sort of naturally occurring nucleoside modifications that you can abrogate this sort of antiviral response. So we thought, well, maybe we could apply that to the problem that we're trying to address, and instead of kill cells, maybe get them to express these reprogramming factors and get to pluripotent stem cells. So we did that, and it worked. I'm not sure what's out there, but it worked in an amazingly efficacious way. So we were trying really just to tackle this issue of non-integrating vector to derive these pluripotent stem cells. We achieved that. At the time, reprogramming cells was really an inefficient process. It turns out that RNA reprogramming was incredibly efficacious. And then, sort of the elephant in the room at the time, in my opinion, was, well, now that we've got iPS cells, we've got to turn them into something that would be potentially clinically useful, and maybe we could use the same technology to do that. So we took these RNA-derived iPS cells, made another RNA, and turned them into muscle cells, and that was also highly efficacious. So that was the study that we published. And it was about, kind of that time that my phone started ringing pretty regularly, where I was getting these calls from sort of the biotech and mostly the pharma industry. And what people on the other end kept saying, hey, we heard about this really great reprogramming technology that you developed. We'd really like to employ it in our pipeline for making pluripotent stem cells. And I was a little bit amazed by this because, to me, what I thought, that was the setting which we did our study in, but really I thought the cool thing was that you could actually use mRNA to express proteins. And so I thought, well, really, might it not be possible to use this technology now for any protein therapeutic application? And so with that idea, and I believe that part of this forum is to sort of discuss translation into sort of biotech. So I set about raising money for this idea and founded a company called Moderna Therapeutics in 2010. And then, Maureen, if I can actually ask you to just click. The company has now been in existence for 7 years, and it has, in fact, keep going, Maureen. It has, that was just the blah, blah, blah about the stem cell study. So, as it turns out, the company was never sort of founded or intended to think about pluripotent stem cells. Rather, it was sort of focused on this idea of, hey, maybe we can use this technology to make therapeutic proteins. And as it turns out, so sort of go back one more, this is the pipeline as of today. So I took this screenshot today. And so there's five phase one trials going on and two that are just about to enter a trial. So the, it's a pretty short time to get into patients like that. And again, it was kind of happenstance to be sort of inspired by this study, which was outside of our field, go into that field to address a question, to find that we couldn't address it the way we thought we were gonna do it. We had to do a workaround, a technological workaround, which turns out to have great utility for other applications. And so I'm very excited by the fact that these clinical programs are going on, and to my mind, and the way I thought about this whole process was that the day that we could make some sort of positive impact on patients' lives would be the day that I felt like we could sort of hang our hat up and say that we achieved something. And that's really what inspires me, and I think anybody who's doing anything translational, or even basic biology that leads to translation, if this can happen, I think this is what we're in the business for. So it's early days, but so far it's safe and efficacious. but I think that, I have three kids, and if they were ill, I would imagine that I would do nothing but sort of day and night think about how I could sort of impact their health. So I'm hopeful that this technology and this strange journey of happenstance achieves that one day for a family.
Thank you very much. We appreciate it. Kevin Egan, you would be up next.
So I have a question for all of you, and that is, have you ever thought about why it is that we have so many treatments for cancer, some of which are really successful now, but we have almost no drugs for the treatment of age-related neurodegenerative conditions? Have you ever thought about why that is? Anybody has no ideas? I'm not going to answer for you. It's not a formal question. Anybody?
Don't be shy.
I won't be shy to wait until somebody raises their hand. I can sit here for a long time. Anybody? I know there's some scientists.
Well, as a matter of fact, cancer cells could potentially develop some kind of resistance to the drugs we apply. So different drugs in the field of chemotherapy target these cells in different ways. So sometimes we give cancer patients multiple drugs in order to eliminate any kind of resistance that the cells have.
I'm going to stop you though. How did we get those drugs in the first place, and why don't we have ones that act on age-related neurodegeneration?
No, I'm going to just say, well, for cancer, we can have a lot of cancer cells, aligned cancer cells, test neurological disease in the neurons.
Yeah, that's basically at the root of the problem. So in cancer, basically the answer is, in cancer, you get sick, part of your body is growing too much. The surgeon cuts it out of you to try to save you, and then they give that to scientists like us to study in the lab and try to come up with clever ways to kill it. So yes, it's true that cancer cells are devilish and that they can escape many of these drugs that we have, but they can escape it because we have the drugs, okay? And the reason that by and large we have the drugs are really two reasons. One, this one, which is really the idea that I was thinking of, but also because we're trying to kill it. And it's pretty easy to kill stuff. For neurodegeneration, you have two polar opposite problems. One is that you get sick because stuff is gone from your body. And if it's gone, you can't study it anymore. And usually by the time you're sick enough to notice, it's so gone that none of it is left to study anymore, at least very little. And certainly not in the way that we do with cancer cell lines. Also, those cells from our brain don't really grow anymore, so it's not like you can take a little bit of them out of the body and make a lot. The other problem is that, with the exception of brain cancers, we're not trying to kill it, we're trying to rehabilitate it and make it work better. And that's a lot harder, as you can see, from government. Okay? So, it's really hard to fix complicated problems, especially when you can't even find the stuff or obtain the stuff. The third problem that people don't think a lot about is that I'm not really anxious, even if I think I might get sick because other family members have, to have my doctors or scientist friends do a brain biopsy on me, okay? And those have really been fundamental barriers to try to understand how our genetic makeup really puts us at risk for getting sick for any number of these things. The final challenge is that for studying these things in the lab, the largest risk factor is age. Okay? And so that also basically makes things more challenging. So getting back to some of the things that Paola and I share interest in, I think some of the models that Paola really described, they are exciting because they allow us to make human brain tissue and other neuronal types from our bodies to actually study in the lab. That is to say, now because of these new stem cell technologies, we can actually make an unlimited amount of that stuff for the first time to study. And by and large, we can use new types of technologies that really are offshoots of early studies in cloning biology that don't actually involve cloning anymore to make them from everybody in this room. In fact, looking out here in my own lab, we've made more stem cell lines from people with psychiatric diseases or amyotrophic lateral sclerosis or Lou Gehrig's disease than there are people sitting in this room right now for any one of those conditions. And I don't know if you can put that that slide up there again. That's just going to play in a loop. I don't have a slideshow, but I have sort of a visual aid, which I like. And these are human brain cells. They're human brain cells from a patient that died of ALS. So that patient's not with us anymore, but we still study their brain all the time to try to understand what happened to try to devise new therapeutics. And what you're actually looking at slowed down is the electrical activity, or the sort of currency of communication, the functionality of those cells. So we're all aware that the way that our brain works is through this very complicated series of electrical impulses that traverse the circuitry of our brain. And what you're looking at is really that functional currency of how a neuron works. And what we're seeing here is actually that electrical activity being turned into a light signal through a genetic modification. So not only can we get the cells, but we can actually look at how they function. And by doing this, we and colleagues at Children's Hospital and Mass General Hospital and GlaxoSmithKline identified a change in these cells from this person and other people like it. It seemed very similar to a change that was being detected in the brains of ALS patients just as they were getting sick. And now that we had so many of these cells in the lab to study, just as people did for cancer cells, we actually looked for drugs that could make them fire normally, make them function like they were supposed to. And now actually that drug, which happened to be an approved seizure medication, is actually in clinical trials for ALS right now at MGH. And there are about 100 ALS patients there and at other clinical centers in the United States that are taking that drug. And we'll see now whether or not that drug can fix their brains, just like it did these cells in addition.
Thank you so much. Harold Ott, you will be next.
Yeah, those have been fascinating stories. So I'm sitting here as a little bit of a, next to these giants, I would say. I enjoy listening to these projects together with you. I like, Jim, that the way you start that quote, you start out saying, I'm not a great scientist, I know I'm not a great scientist. It pretty much is quintessential environment. It describes the environment of the Harvard STEM Center. I'll explain to you a little bit why. So I'm a surgeon, right? So I'm the end user of a lot of these technologies. Before I start my story, I'm going to ask you, how many of you have a Toyota? Okay. Less than I expected. How many have a Chevy? A lot of us. Okay. So why did you pick your Toyota? Well, there's two people who put their hands up, so you picked the Toyota. You gotta tell me that. Why did you pick it? You like the way it drove?
That's not the point. The thing I wanted to hear was, what else?
It's expensive. It's safe. There's a lot more reasons to buy a Toyota now. The bottom line is, it's reliable, right? It lasts for a very long time. It's got the Toyota Corolla or something, has the reputation, it's been on the road for the longest, or lasts for a very long time. And the reason why I'm using that analogy is because what happens if you drive it for 20 years? Something breaks, right? And what happens if something breaks? What happens if the transmission breaks on the Corolla? Don't tell me you're going to buy a new Corolla. You switch it out, right? So the way I think many areas in industry have changed over the years, the parts that we consume or devices that we use, machines, if something breaks, you switch it out. You don't repair it. You don't bring it to a repair shop where somebody will take your transmission apart. It would be unaffordable, right? Take a transmission apart and then fix it and put it back together, put it back in. It would last another year. It would take 2 weeks. It would be expensive. No, that's not effective, so we just switch it out. Medicine is a little different. If you're a surgeon, it's very much like being a mechanic to a certain extent. You learn a craftsmanship of repairing things, right? But you spend 10 years of training on trying to perfect and learn protocols and overcome the same procedures so that you can repair broken body parts. Somewhere in that training, I noticed when I was training as a cardiac surgeon, I noticed that even if you do the perfect operation on somebody, they will walk away with very limited organ function. And that's a shift that has happened in medicine. We got better and better at getting people to survive acute conditions. So there used to be something like the golden hour in trauma, or when you have a heart attack, there used to be this time, well, you have a heart attack, now the clock starts ticking, you're gonna get to the cath lab within a certain period of time, right? These were the things that were perfected in medicine over the past 20, 30 years. When we arrive at the end of that is that we do the perfect job to get somebody through an acute event, but they end up with a damaged organ, damaged system. Now they walk away living with decent quality of life, and that's how we all make it through life. But at some point, they'll hit the point where organ failure sets in and their quality of life is so limited because their heart is just pumping at 10% function. And even if you do the perfect operation on that patient, you just can't make a big difference there anymore. You're dealing with the broken part, you're patching it, if you will, but you can't get it to regenerate or to get better, right? Now, this is where I stood about almost 15 years ago now, as a resident doing heart, learning how heart operations and realizing that fact that we're just not able to bring the function of that organ back to regenerate it. And so I started to get into cell therapy and realized that at the time the big hype was to inject single cells or stem cells, or what we thought were stem cells, into organs that were failing, trying to repair them. Now the issue with that was that if you have something that's really broken, you know, to fix that with cells alone just didn't quite pan out. So in some conditions cells turn out to be helpful, but in conditions where, let's say, heart failure, where your heart is really broken, where its architecture is distorted and its function is so limited that it's under load constantly, cells alone just didn't do the job. And so I learned about a field called tissue engineering and organ engineering. And so the rest of my time will help me talk about this. It's basically the idea that we can use these tools you've heard about today, the stem cells. You've heard about two very important tools, stem cells and development, right? So making parts from a person, making cells that were building blocks from a person, and then applying development to turn them into something that we need. We can use these tools and apply them in an attempt to make organs for transplantation, make tissues to help patients who have lost organ function due to injury. The way this started was that actually here in Boston, the concept of tissue engineering was publicized by putting a little ear on the back of a rat. Some of you might remember that paper that ran around the world in the 1990s, right? And that paper was really important because it showed a basic principle that living organs or living tissues are made out of two things. They're made out of a scaffolding material, and they're made out of cells that work in that environment. So it's like an office building, if you will, right? You have this infrastructure, piping and all that, and people living there doing the job. Then the heart, you know, it's the valves and the blood vessels and the heart muscle cells, and you contract in the heart, or in the lungs, the blood vessels and the structure, and it's the cells in it that enable the gas exchange. And so in the mid-2000s, when I started to think about tissue engineering, I read that paper, it was fascinating, and I thought, well, maybe one could apply that to make whole organs instead of just making tissues, two-dimensional tissues like skin or blood vessels. And so what we did is developed a process to, instead of making that scaffolding from scratch, we developed a process to take cadaveric organs and wash them free of all cells and end up with an organ blueprint. We did that, we showed that we can make little hearts that beat again by seeding them with hogwash and heart muscle cells and made organs that function to a certain extent. But all of this was highly clinically irrelevant, right? It was an interesting science experiment, but at that time we didn't have these important tools that you heard about yet from today. So we didn't have the tools to make stem cells for the patient, and we didn't have the tools to guide these stem cells to development so that they would organize back into functional tissue. And that's where I got really lucky and somehow found my way to MGH and into the Harvard Stem Cell Institute, to the Center for Regenerative Medicine. I got to work with all these smart people that you heard talk earlier before. So now when we use our technology of organ assembly, what we try to do is we try to use building blocks that are patient specific, so stem cells that are derived from the actual person that needs an organ, and we drive these cells through known milestones in development to get them to form heart muscle cells or lung cells and or kidney cells, pancreas cells, cells of different organ systems. And then using the principle of tissue engineering, we try to reassemble this as a therapeutic itself. So the cell is not a model, or it's not a producer of something, but the cell itself becomes the therapeutic as it is built into this new organ that can then eventually hopefully be transplanted into patients. So now you get, I think, why I use the car analogy. Hopefully medicine is moving in the direction at some point where the part is totally broken, we can just switch it out. And transplantation has shown us that we can do that, right? But the problem is that donor organ shortage is so severe that we have 500,000 patients on dialysis and we do several thousand transplants per year in the country. So there's this big divide. So what we try to do is come up with a solution to that by growing tissues on demand that can be transplanted. So where have we gotten with this? Well, we've generated little functional systems in small animal models we've gotten as far as transplanting large, so human size organs into large animals. They function not at a very high level yet, and these are just baby steps in the first steps in the right direction. But it's something that in this environment, with this with the support of our collaborators and with the support of high risk funding, as Paula had mentioned before from the Harvard STEM Institute, we're able to pull through, even understanding that this is a longer term perspective towards really finding cures for any organ failure.
Well, thank you so much. Do you have these cards or whatever it is? Can I ask a question to start, which is a non-technical one, and then we can get into the scientists and wimpy scientists in the room? I want to return to my conversation with John Gruber this morning about no science advisor to the president. And my response was to him on the radio, I agree with you, but come to think of it, I can't name one science advisor for a president, nor can I name what he or she ever said. And he said, that's part of my point. The obligation is not just to advise the president about science, the obligation is to educate the public about the importance of science. Do any of you feel that's part of your job, in addition to describing what you just did a minute ago? Do you feel any obligation to convince lay people like me why science matters in their lives, not in some abstract sort of way? Paula, you're not in agreement. You do?
I mean, we're here, right?
Well, tonight, yes, that's true.
But our
title is also, across the board, probably professor.
Professor,
I think it's important to remember that, we're all teachers and, pedagogy and, really passing on knowledge, information broadly to another generation of young people and adults is our profession.
I also mean the larger populations. I have to say, before you answer, as a person who tries pretty hard to be prepared, science is one of the things that is really intimidating to me. And when I'm approached by somebody like you, who is kind and generous enough to try to explain in very basic language this huge and important thought, it is much more likely that I'll communicate it beyond your classroom, beyond your lab. And so, but Paula, you're gonna say something.
Yes, I completely agree with you that we have this responsibility as well, because ultimately we're doing all of this together. It's not just the scientists in the lab that think of an experiment that could have an impact. It's really all of you understanding the importance of doing this kind of science. From my point of view, also the importance of taking risks in science to make bigger discoveries that can really impact human lives quicker and more. And this only comes if we're able to speak the same language. Sometimes it's hard to explain exactly what we do, but I am a big believer that there's always a way to talk with each other so that we understand the core of it. But what are we really doing here? So we should start every description of what we do with something like, why do we do this and what is the problem? Why didn't it work in the past? And here is the new thing that we're doing that might be extremely powerful. So then it trickles down to a really an understanding of the value of the work, which then impacts policy, for example, and funding that can foster the continuation of this work. I think life is too short to do boring science. And the kind of problems we have and the kind of diseases that we're trying to understand and eventually cures are so complex that we shouldn't waste too much time doing boring science. So this is a key component of really being all in understanding of what we're trying to do.
And when people like you, Derek, mentioned a minute ago, my three kids had an ailment, this is what that connects so intimately and personally with real people. It's amazing. So
yeah, I'll just make a comment, and I'm not sure if I'm on or not.
Are you on?
Do I have to do something?
Is there a
sure. So I think that really just to pick up on the point that Kevin and Paula made, scientists do feel a responsibility to do this, but it's actually not that often that you sort of get invited to a public forum or a radio show or a forum that you can communicate with, anybody outside of your specialty or your colleagues. But I think generally speaking, when we do get that invite, most of us, if we can at all possibly do it, take that opportunity. But it's a little bit surprising to me because, moreover, the public finds science very fascinating. They love it. They love to, you know, and a good scientist can easily communicate the ideas and bring it down to a level that absolutely everybody can understand. So I'm a little bit surprised that there's not more sort of forums for that that have sort of caught on and become like sort of big media sensations.
But the reason,
I mean, there's
the
science
for that is we're intimidated. I mean, we really are intimidated, and I don't mean to transfer the burden, but I will to you. When there's a hook, when there's a story in the news that's in your bailiwick, reaching out, even if they don't reach out to you, to a reporter who covers science in the Globe or somebody who's a science reporter at WGBH, I cannot tell you how grateful they'd be. And the reason it's sad that they may not call you is because I worry that I'm not going to be able to digest what you have to say and then translate it into a language that people who rely on me can consume. So it's a two-way street. In any case, you know, some of you wrote down what your actual questions were, and I realized rather than me just talking endlessly, why don't I just call your name, and you can repeat with a microphone. Is that okay with you? What you actually wrote on this little card here. Can we do that? James Black, where are you? Oh, hello, James Black. You're right there. There's the microphone. And this is the palette, yes?
Yes.
Take it away.
Yeah. Yeah, I was interested in this concept of brain organoids. I've been attending the ISSCR conference over the last several years. This is the first time for me to hear this term, brain organoid. And my question is about possible connections and repair that you do for a diseased brain. Can you envision those same therapeutic methods possibly being used to repair the surgery in an injured brain?
So this is a fantastic question. And I will soon pass the microphone also to Kevin, who has a really deep knowledge of neurodegenerative disease and the approaches there. But you can think about the capacity to make brain-like tissue in the dish for sort of two broad purposes. The first would be for cell replacement, so for replacing neurons or nerve cells in the brain that may have died because of a neurodegenerative disease, for example. The second would be to model disease, which means to have something in the dish that you can look at, study, look inside cells, look at the behavior of the tissue to understand what might be wrong if that tissue came from a patient with a certain disease. So the second application leads you to better understanding of what the disease is, and possibly it's a way into identifying drugs that may ameliorate the disease. The first, it's really the replacement component that Harold was talking about. If you don't have the cells anymore in the brain, what would you do? And so there are efforts in the field, of course, not from my lab, but from many other labs, and you've probably seen some of this work at ISSCR, that turn stem cells into specific types, for example, of nerve cells that may have died in a certain disease. Take Parkinson's disease. So in this disease, there is a specific set of neurons that die. Not all of the neurons dies in the brain of Parkinson's patient, a very specific one that died. And so in that, and we know that in that context, what these neurons do, among the many things that they do, is to secrete a molecule called dopamine, which is a molecule to communicate with other parts of the nervous system. So what if we could replace those neurons that die with new ones that are derived from stem cells and replenish this capacity to make dopamine? Would that ameliorate the disease? And there is a lot of data in the field suggesting that that might be the case. So there is a lot of effort, for example, for Parkinson, to take this technology and turn it into a replacement strategy for that disease. And maybe, Kevin, you can say something about these specific efforts.
Yeah, well, I was, you know, just to go back to the question of, yeah, you know, traumatic brain injury and, you know, organoid technologies, you know, I showed you these pictures of the, you know, the cells in the dish, and, you know, while, you know, it's exciting that for the first time we can access these human cells. The cells of those, you know, the activity of those cells in the dish is like a rudimentary, you know, shadow play of the complex things that happen in our brain. And, you know, they're just kind of the first manifestation, the most crude manifestation of human neural activity that we can hope to measure. And it's far from the complexity of what we have. It's like, it's not even like the computer that I had as a kid compared to what we have today. And I think, you know, the reason people are excited about the types of technologies that Hal and I are developing is because they come closer to building something that approximates a small piece of our brain and has some of the emergent properties of our brain. And I think, you know, the goal for that is to hope to understand those, you know, those properties of the brain in a context you can actually do an experiment on them, because you need to understand how that circuitry works so that you can understand how to repair it after it's damaged. And I think that, to me, is, you know, why I look at what you're doing and think this is so, we need this.
Okay, in the words of Marx, Groucho, there's nothing like good planning, and this is nothing like good planning. Nobody put their names on any of the cards, so, so much for calling on you. I will read a question to all of you from somebody. You think we're on the brink of a new century of regenerative medicine? Who wants to take that? Not all at once. Who wants to take that? Do you think we're on the brink of a new century of regenerative medicine?
I think it's a new century. It's also regenerative medicine is an evolving field. I heard that quote at one of the conferences, and it has been for the past 10 years, right? I think things are complicated in some ways. We are learning a lot of the tools. And a lot of the aspects of stem cell biology, developmental biology, I think are at the point where they're coming together, where they can be applied. And as a surgeon and as an organ engineer, if you will, or bioengineer, I find the current time particularly exciting is because I see, even as a non-developmental biologist or as a non-stem cell biologist, that we now have tools that we can do an engineering approach, apply to generate tissues of high level. So this is something that decades of scientists have tried to map out and figure out for us, right? Describe how the lung branch is going to develop, sort of how the little alveoli form, or how heart muscle compacts and turns into a left ventricle, or how the kidney nephron forms. These are processes that have took a long time to figure out, to describe, to isolate, to replicate in vitro, to study how they actually happen. And now, like Kevin said in Paul's, it's a using adult stem cells, we can actually make them happen again, right? We can replicate that process of direct differentiation, that's one big term, or then actually morphogenesis to a certain extent, create tissues of increasing complexity and study them and potentially use them as a therapeutic. So while regenerative medicine has been around for a decade or more, I think, or the idea behind it has been around, I think that the advances towards actually getting these tools into clinical useful applications has grown exponentially over the last 5 years. And if that trend continues, I'm very enthusiastic about this century, if you will.
Thank you. Okay. Yeah.
All right.
So fair comment.
I actually believe that we're, and I say this to people, that we're at a really important point, because cell-based therapy is coming and it's here. We're at its nascence right now, and it's happening first in the blood. So hematopoietic stem cell transplantations are going on for a while, but now we're engineering T cells to go after cancer. And so, and this is really sort of really firmly taking hold in clinical centers around the world. So the types of facilities and the infrastructure that you need to do cell-based therapy are being set up everywhere. And so that's sort of paving the way, and blood often paves the way. And the reason it does is because blood is liquid tissue, and it doesn't need to sort of integrate into a solid structure, which almost every other tissue type does. But I think it's paving the way. Setting up that infrastructure is really important, because you have to have this infrastructure in order to envision cell-based therapy. And then the second thing I'll say is, you know, to the point of what really Kevin and Paula work on, which is using ex vivo models to particularly, you know, address diseases and then screen for not cells that can ameliorate that, but actually compounds and chemical matter to sort of ameliorate the disease. That is happening. It's in the clinic. And there are many more things that are on the way. And many of these approaches are regenerative medicine. So, for example, a colleague that I know, Pella and Kevin know very well, who's coming to the meeting, is from Case Western, Paul Tesar. And he's, you know, developed a beautiful system for an ex vivo platform for oligodendrocyte sort of stimulation. And these are the cells that sort of wrap central nervous system neurons to make them function better. It's the myelin. And, you know, he's used his platform to discover molecules that can now go into patients suffering from demyelinating disorders. And the treatment would be regenerative therapy. So I do believe that we're both on the nascent of both sort of small molecule based on ex vivo modeling, but also cell-based therapy. So I think it's actually going to be a very exciting time over the next several decades.
Very thank you. Leonora, you actually did put your name on the card. Where are you? Hi, Leonora. How are you? What's great?
Can I have my card back?
You have the question.
You have too many questions on it. Okay, so Paula and Harold, actually, this is a question for both of you. Okay, so first, how far you can direct, you have to direct your cells to make organic. This is some of the, this is self-organization procedure. And tissue engineering, in tissue engineering, you put the cells together with scaffold biomaterial in different ways, but whatever. But this is something which is man-made to some degree. Okay, so what is the point these two methods will meet to make the blocks and to forward tissue engineering based on organoids. Okay, so this is kind of making the things faster and better. So this and okay. So self-organization.
Yes. How far? Maybe another way, if I understand your question, another way to phrase it. How far do you need or do you want or to let the tissue develop on its own, perhaps,
yes, this is the first thing.
Right, following a normal process of development that stem cell progenitor or cell of the brain will follow, and how much would be useful instead or in combination to take on bioengineering approaches to also direct a little bit the formation of a tissue to fit a need,
yeah.
Right?
Actually, to put on it, okay?
Yes, to fit
as
the need. Yes, to, for example, make a specific organ, or it all depends on what ultimately you want to do with it. So maybe the brain is not,
brain.
You want only brain.
Because it's the most complicated.
It's the most complicated. So you have put your finger on it. It is extremely complicated, and for all the studies and all the thinking and all the experiments to understand how the development of the brain works, we still know very little about that. And that's why there is this fresh discovery that this self-organization can happen in the dish that helps you a little bit make a tissue-like structure that ultimately would be very hard to make simply by instructing every step of the way from that stem cell, because we do not know every step, okay? And there is also the thought in the field now, and again, this comes from studying really these organs, that the fidelity with which the cells you make from a self-organizing system compared to the endogenous cells, the cells that you normally have in a human brain, is high. So because they develop following similar principles, the idea is that they end up being kind of more similar. There is a lot of work that has to be done there, so I don't want to push it too much. So I think that it will be a merge between bioengineering and development and stem cell biology and neurobiology to understand and put together a brain-like tissue that is usable for some of the application that Derek was mentioning. Will replacement of the brain be the ultimate goal? No, because it's a very complex tissue. We all know that it doesn't work, cells don't work on their own, right, in the brain. They have to be connected in a specific way and so on and so forth. Although there are spaces, like the example I gave for Parkinson's disease, where cell replacement may be very beneficial in that specific case. But they may turn into those perfect platforms where we screen drugs, and maybe one other application that Derek didn't say, we may begin to think about personalized medicine, whereby even the diagnostic of some disease may happen with your own brain-like tissue. And yeah, so I guess that's my
answer. Harold, you want to be part of this?
Yeah, I think you put your finger right on it, right? The dilemma we work with is that there's a couple of dilemmas. One, it's nature versus nurture in some ways, in the sense that cells have a certain program on their own to go down a path, right? And if you want to make one organ, not just all sorts of organs, then you need to control that to a certain extent. But then there's you have to bring the right environment, basically, to take advantage of the endogenous potential of self-organization, but then from a bioengineer's perspective, drive it towards something that could be useful as a therapeutic. And so these two technologies get married somewhere in that middle point, and where that middle point is exactly what we're trying to figure out, right? Because if you think of a patient heart failure, and I always take it back to the clinic who walks in and needs a heart, well, the patient can maybe wait for a year or two, but for you or me to grow a heart takes of appropriate size would take 12, 15 years, right? So now we can't apply something that will take 12 or 15 years to make an organ for somebody to replace it, even if we could do that. So we will need to find shortcuts, and we'll need to find ways to control the structure formation in these organs in a more proactive way, and try to find ways to bridge that gap.
Yeah. And another one on the top of it is growing organs in an animal.
Right.
So
right.
It is completely different technology, but still.
Thank you both. By the way, I can't read any of the other cards, so much for the card system. Raise your hand if you had a question, and I'll call on you and we'll say who you are. And a gentleman over there spoke before. What's your name, please, and what's the question?
My name is Chris Rosa. I'm an intern at Harvard Stem Institute this summer. First of all, thank you very much for those small talks that just arise my excitement. Each field that you presented. Well, my question goes to Dr. Paola Arulada. You talk about brain organoids, and the first thing that came to my mind is neurodegenerative diseases. But you had some kind of emphasis on neuropsychiatric diseases. Why is that?
So it sort of goes back to this idea of what you can use the cellular system for. So you can think about cell replacement. But again, as Kevin was saying, the brain is a very complex system. And it's really a system. Cells don't work on their own in the brain to give you brain function, right? They have to be connected a certain way. They have to be wired. They have to be next to neighbors and so on and so forth in the correct sort of way. So cell replacement strategies in the brain, with some very important exceptions where maybe this level of precise connectivity is not critical to the function of the neurons you're trying to replace, then are very difficult. I think, I also think though, that there is a huge potential for impacting this field of regenerative medicine in a different way. It doesn't require to transplant the cells or brain-like tissue in the actual brain, but it uses that system to understand the disease, to then find a treatment for it, a drug, chemical treatment, or a genetic treatment that can ameliorate the disease itself or stop it from developing. And that has a huge value. And so I think that some of the first applications you're going to see here are in the realm of modeling this disease in the dish to develop new therapeutics.
We have about 6 or 7 minutes left, I think, or thereabouts. Is Srinjoy, did I say it right? Oh, actually, you, but I can read a name. I'll get to that in a second. Sir, what's your name and what's the question?
Hi, Emily, question for Dr. Rossman. First question is, can you produce your modified mRNA with a thyroid linker on either side? If so, have you tried to use antibody to direct the mRNA to specific cells for therapeutic development?
So the second question was a delivery question, and it's really important. The first one, I'm not sure I quite
got. Thyroid linker to the mRNA.
There's plenty of modifications that you can do to the mRNA. It's just got to be able to fit through the ribosome and properly encode. So there's various types of, there's actually 110 known nucleoside modifications in all cells of all of our bodies. But there's other modifications that have been employed, for example, by the RNAi industry, you know, SIs, to make them more stable. So the chemistry of mRNA is a huge universe, so and much of that is being explored with the provision, as I said, that it has to fit through the ribosome and it has to encode what you expect it to encode. The second issue is a really important one, which is how do you, I'll just paraphrase, so mRNA is a gigantic charged macromolecule. So how on earth do you target that in the cells? How do you get cells to take that up? And is there any way to target it specifically to this tissue or that tissue? To be honest, that really is the challenge in the field, is delivery. If you're ever trying to deliver a very large macromolecule to cells, this is very challenging. So, but, you know, there are various technologies that actually seem to be effective for this. It's gonna be tissue specific, so I'll give you the one, you know, very effective way to deliver to one cell type in the body, which is these lipid nanoparticles, which have a tropism for the liver. And the liver is a gigantic organ, 10 to the 11th cells, I believe. And you know, we've shown in animal models that you put mRNA into a lipid nanoparticle, essentially get that mRNA to every single hepatocyte in the liver. So all of a sudden, you've got 10 to the 11 cells producing protein for you, and you can produce an awful lot of protein, and that's your engine. But other tissues are more challenging. Skeletal muscle and cardiac muscle works because there's something in the muscle contraction that when a muscle contracts, it lends the membrane, either transiently porous, but allows uptake of mRNA without a delivery vehicle. It's amazing. But you know, getting into other tissue types with gigantic micromolecules is really a challenge. The antibody idea that you mentioned, you know, tag it to an antibody, and I'm assuming you mean to sort of specifically target a cell type and have it as a carrier, might get it to the proximity of the cell, but getting it inside the cell is going to be a more challenging task. But never say never, because you can imagine if you can target a cell and somehow, you know, trigger endocytosis in some way, shape, or form, you might be able to use this. I think it's an interesting idea. We haven't explored it, but I like the way you're thinking.
I was asked to ask for a show of hands, who's here for the ISSCR meeting? Could you raise your hand if you were one of those people? Can I ask another, do you need any more than that, Maureen, wherever you are? Does that do it? Can I ask another layperson's question that maybe is to you, but maybe to you four also? How worried are you about assuming that a budget not unlike that which has been filed by the administration were to become law? How much at risk is the kind of work that they're doing and people in this room are doing or hope to do? You want to answer that or you're not?
Sure.
Or any of you? You
have, well, you guys can answer. We can have a combination that.
Rob.
So we are worried about that because, as I said, the platform that underlies the work that we're doing here in this country is really funded by the government. Through the National Institutes of Health, and you know, as well as other government agencies. But so a lot of the fundamental work is supported by the government and open-ended science.
And what are we talking now, maybe 30% proposed cuts or something in that neighborhood?
Yeah, so there's 20 to 30% proposed cuts. And so that would have a significant impact on, if you imagine taking 20 or 30% of, you know, the foundation out from under the work that we're doing. Because what we do as a philanthropic is that we raise money from philanthropy, from donors, and fund on top of the work that the government is doing. And so we can't replace, I mean, you know, don't forget, the NIH budget is $30 billion. You take out 20 to 30% of that and you're having major impact. There's no way you can supplement that through private philanthropy, corporate money, et cetera. And there have been discussions about, you know, whether that happens or not is still an open question. There are variations on a theme where people are talking about capping senior scientists compared to junior scientists and what are those trade-offs. And so there's a lot of discussion about sort of how to do that, as well as people are talking about overhead charges to institutions, because there's not only the direct cost, but the associated cost. So the short answer is we're worried. The short answer, I think, is also that there's, because of some of the examples that you heard here, the open-ended nature of scientific discovery, the fact that we want to keep it open-ended, means you have to have that sort of support that can't just be saying, how do you solve problem X if we don't know what problem X is, or some of these different tools that we develop along the way. So I think it's really government's role that can enable that sort of open-ended discovery, and then private money, corporate money, investor money, et cetera, can come in on top of it.
Fair enough. We have time for another question, too, and I'm told that I think most, if not all, of these people are going to stick around a little bit after if you want to have individual conversation subject to their time. Yes, sir. Your name is, please.
I'm Stranger, and my question is for Dr. Roth. It's a surgical sort of question. Do you see the antigenicity to the scaffolds when you do the transplant? Antigenicity for scaffolds and let not fly off. What was the second part of the question? Sir? The antigenicity to scaffolds.
Yeah,
and the second. The clone cells, the cells that are being induced to function, how hard or how easy it is to induce them to function well? And the third is, do you really get enough number of cells? And if you do, there's a tumor potential to passaging cells number of times, especially after B6. So how do you solve this problem?
I think those are three excellent questions. The antigenicity, luckily, scaffolds in their form, in that decellularized form, don't elicit a specific immune response. That's our belief at this point. That if you receive a transplant, as you know, the immune response, the specific immune response that the recipient forms during the rejection is against the cell surface proteins or mismatch in cell surface proteins. Your body recognizes something to be either from a different individual in allotransplantation or from a different species in xenotransplantation. We know that with decellularization, so removing all the cells from native scaffolds, we can get rid of that immune response. Here's FDA-approved biomeshes that are decellularized human or animal skin, livers, other tissues that are transplanted, implanted as biomaterial, basically, that don't elicit a specific immune response. Now, that doesn't mean that there's no immune response, though. So whenever somebody refers to the scaffold material as something that's non-immunogenic, I think that's a dangerous statement, because any empty collagen, so any empty scaffold in your body, will induce a very specific remodeling fibrotic response. And if you fix a hernia, that's great. But if you're not fixing a hernia, but you're trying to generate a lung, for example, that can quickly turn into pulmonary fibrosis and destroy your graft. So I think controlling the remodeling response, if you will, that we see in response to a non-perfectly coated or not perfectly regenerated scaffold is something that we worry about quite a bit. It's something we're looking into. Now, the second part of your question, if I understood correctly, was how easy is it to drive these cells to mature function? And I think a lot of the body literature that we build on has shown us how to get single cells to develop single cell fates, right? So we published trying to drive an iPS cell towards becoming a pneumocyte, or a cell that makes surfactant, for example, for the lung, or a cell that becomes a heart muscle cell. Now,
these protocols work out great on a single cell fake level, so the cells display markers of adulthood, if you will, or of maturity. I feel like where we currently stand is we're trying to get these cells to then form tissues or higher level function, and we're not very good at that yet. So yes, we can make pneumocytes, but can we truly make a respiratory epithelium? Not quite yet, right? The quite is, of course, on the line. So that's exactly what we're working on. What are the signals that we need to turn on, or what are the mechanical and stimuli, basically, that we need to expose these constructs to in a three-dimensional context to mature higher-level function? The last question you asked is a good question. That's where the best thing that happened to me were stem cells, or adult stem cells in some shape or form, because up until that point, making a heart the size of a cherry or a small piece of tissue was one thing, but growing the 10 billion or 5 billion endothelial cells it takes to coat a single lung, for example, was totally out of proportion. Right? Because you couldn't propagate an adult endothelial cells for so long. And as you know, one of the key characteristics of a stem cell is it can multiply, right? It can self-replicate without losing the potential for self-replication. Aside of that pluripotency that can become anything that you need it to become, in theory. So we build on that potential, say we can produce enough cells, and whether there's genetic instability throughout that process, that is something that needs to be carefully monitored. But I think that risk can be, to a certain extent, handled as you're looking at an exponential expansion. Getting to a number of 10 billion cells is not something that's impossible by any means. So I think that is something that we'll have to put that gap, we'll have to bridge carefully, but it's not a conceptual gap, it's something that it's more of a technology issue that can be addressed using current techniques.
On that note, can you join me in thanking Paola, Derek, Kevin, and Harold, please?